What's up with the turbo button on old PCs? What does pressing it actually do? And is it true that turbo mode actually slows down the CPU? Let's try to figure it out and solve the mystery. The first PC with a turbo button was the Eagle Turbo XL, announced in April 1984. It had an 8 MHz 8086 processor, which they claimed was up to twice as fast as the 4.77 MHz 8088 used by the IBM PC, XT, and most other PC clones at the time. InfoWorld magazine wrote that a push of the button on the front panel next to the stylized racing stripes lights the turbo logo in red and shifts the computer into turbo drive. The change can be accomplished even in the middle of running a program. Eagle Computer sales manager Larry Bouffard joked that there's no time to get a cup of coffee while the turbo sorts a database. People who use that time to goof off are in trouble. For those who wanted the advantage of turbo speed without buying a whole new computer, in late 1984, Orchid Technology introduced the PC Turbo 186, the first accelerator card for IBM PCs and clones. They said simply install the PC Turbo adapter board and Orchid's productivity software, and your PC becomes a powerful turbo-driven computer. Or you could replace the motherboard of your IBM XT with an aftermarket Turbo XT motherboard, such as this one sold by JDR Microdevices. But the faster speed of turbo mode could cause problems with some software and hardware. Copy-protected applications like Lotus 123 might refuse to run, games would play too fast, and even worse, saving files to disk or transferring them over a modem could result in lost or corrupted data. So many Turbo XT systems would boot up in standard 4.77 MHz speed, and then the user could enable turbo mode by pressing a key combination or typing in a DOS command if they were sure it wouldn't cause any problems. This annoyed Lieutenant Ray P. Stallings of San Francisco, who wrote a letter to PC Magazine in 1987 complaining about having to press Ctrl-Alt-Plus to enable turbo mode every time he turned on his computer. By then, the compatibility problems had largely been resolved, so many computers started coming with a button allowing you to leave turbo mode enabled all the time and then switch off when needed, such as for playing older games. Now let's go back to the studio and take a look at a few different PCs from the 80s and 90s with turbo buttons, so we can learn how they operate. Here's the oldest PC I have with a turbo button. It's a Zenith Z-148 from 1986, and I was getting all ready to demonstrate it for you, except the RIFA cap and the power supply blew just a few minutes before I was ready to start filming it. So unfortunately, I'll have to save that demonstration for a later video. In their brochure for it, Zenith said, "We just raised the limit on PC processing speed limits. Based on the industry standard MS-DOS operating system, the Z148 PC features a powerful 16-bit Intel 8088 processor. When you run the Z148 PC at its full 8 MHz, it proves, I think they meant provides, an unsurpassed 60% faster rate than comparable PC models." And this unmarked button on the front panel controls the CPU speed. If you leave it popped out like this, it runs at 4.77 MHz, the same speed as the original IBM PC. And if you push it in, you can hear it click. If you push it in, it runs at 8 MHz. So this is an early example of a turbo button from 1986. Now here is a typical early to mid-90s mini tower PC. On the front panel you can see it has a reset button, a turbo button which clicks in and out, indicator LEDs for power, turbo, and hard disk drive access, a knockout plug for where a CPU speed readout LED would have gone if this was equipped with it, but it doesn't have it, so it's just a plastic panel there. And finally, a key lock, which doesn't actually physically lock the case. Instead, it locks out access to the keyboard. So if you have this in the locked position, nobody can type anything on the keyboard. It has a 33 MHz 486 SLCE processor designed by Cyrix and manufactured by Texas Instruments. And on the motherboard, you can find the typical pinouts for the key lock and power LED, the speaker, the reset button, the turbo LED, and the turbo switch. But you can see the connector going to the turbo switch has three wires on it, while the pin header on the motherboard for the turbo switch only has two pins on it. So there's two possible ways to connect the turbo switch. Now here's what happens if I turn it on with the gray and black wires going from the turbo button to the motherboard pinout for the turbo switch. With the turbo button not pushed in, you can see the turbo indicator is not lit. You could hear the pitch of that memory test when it was starting up. Now, if I push in the button, the turbo indicator LED illuminates, and I'll reset it. Listen to that memory test. Notice how much higher pitch that is? So even just by listening to the ticking noise that the memory check during startup makes, you can tell whether or not this thing is running at full speed or low speed. But just to verify, I'll run a benchmark with the button pushed in and the turbo indicator LED lit. You can see it says 33 megahertz CPU clock, and I'll run the landmark speed test. And it says this computer performs like 140 MHz AT with a 95 MHz 287. Obviously, this is an old version that doesn't properly recognize the 486 SLCE. So instead, it thinks it's a 486 DX. So this is running with the turbo button pushed in and the turbo indicator LED lit. And now I'll run that same benchmark with the button not pushed in and the turbo indicator LED not lit. And listen to that change in the beeping. And now it says this computer performs like a 25 megahertz AT with a 62 megahertz 287. So this is with the turbo button not pushed in. And this is with the turbo button pushed in. To give a better idea of the difference in performance between turbo mode and non-turbo mode on this system, I'll run Norton system information. First, here is the CPU speed benchmark with the turbo mode disabled. And it gives it a score of 8, which is similar to a 286. Now I'll turn on turbo mode. And you can see it jumps up all the way to 54.4, which is quite a bit faster than the 33 MHz 386. So this is turbo mode, and that is non-turbo mode. So this is the way I always had this computer configured, and it's the way it made the most sense to me. With the turbo button pushed in, and the turbo indicator LED lit, it's running at the full CPU speed. And if I unpush the button and the turbo indicator LED is not lit, you can see it's running a lot slower now. But what happens if we change that connection to the turbo button so that the gray and yellow wires are connected instead of the black and gray wires? Now if I turn it on with the turbo button pushed in, you can see the turbo LED is not lit, and listen to the memory check. You can hear that lower pitch, which means it's not running in turbo mode. And now if I unpush the turbo button, the light comes on. Now if I reset it, listen to that memory test again. A higher pitch, which means it's running in turbo mode now. So this is why I think people are getting confused and thinking that engaging turbo mode slows down your computer, because they may have had their button configured like this, where not pushed in is turbo mode, but pushed in is non-turbo mode, which does slow down your computer. And maybe they had a system which only had the button and not the indicator LED. So then they would think, oh, what's the deal with this? You push it in, it makes your computer slower instead of faster. But if you have the turbo indicator LED when it's lit, that always means the CPU is running at full speed. And if it's not lit, that means it's running at slow speed, regardless of how you have this button wired. Well, here it is without the turbo button connected, so regardless of whether I have it pushed in or not, it doesn't make any difference, it's not connected. And I'll turn it on, and you can see it starts up in non-turbo mode. So the default on this motherboard, if you don't have a turbo button connected, is that it starts up in non-turbo mode. So if you wanted to install this in a case that did not have a turbo button, you would need to put a jumper on that pin header on the motherboard so that it would start up in turbo mode. But even without that turbo button connected, I can still switch it between turbo mode and non-turbo mode with a keyboard command. Control, Alt, and the plus key on the numeric keypad switches it into turbo mode. You can see the LED lit up, and you can hear the beep changed pitch in the landmark CPU speed test. And Control, Alt, and the numeric keypad minus switches it back to non-turbo mode. So that's how you can switch the turbo mode on and off with the keyboard. Control plus turns it on, control minus turns it off. Here's the manual for a later 486 motherboard with PCI slots, and it matches exactly what I just showed. J4 is a 2-pin connector for the turbo switch, and it says close for a higher speed while open for a slower speed. A BIOS hotkey Control Alt Plus also brings system to a higher speed, while Control Alt Minus set system to a slower speed. And they say the turbo indicator LED is on when higher speed is selected. Now here's a name brand factory built PC from the 90s with a turbo button. It's a Gateway 2000 4DX33. And this one is a little bit different than what we've seen so far because the turbo button does not push in and pop out. It is a momentary contact button, so it's just a toggle. And if we run the landmark speed test on it, we get a score of 158 with the turbo mode enabled and the indicator LED lit. And if I push the button to disable turbo mode, it drops down all the way to 15.3. So clearly, turbo mode with the LED lit is the full CPU speed, and non-turbo mode with the LED not lit is a much slower speed. In turbo mode, this 486DX is quite a bit faster than a 386 running at the same clock speed of 33 megahertz. But if I disable turbo mode, it brings it down all the way to about the same speed as a 286. Although even in non-turbo mode, some really old DOS games are still a bit too fast to be playable. Turbo buttons and turbo indicator LEDs started to disappear from PCs by the mid-1990s because by then fewer people still had the need to run old speed-sensitive hardware and software, and CPUs were getting fast enough that even in non-turbo mode, they were often still too fast to play old DOS games from the 80s. Plus, I think it was simply a matter of cost-cutting to eliminate a button and LED that few people had a need for, just like the aforementioned key lock, which disappeared from most computers at the time as well. So, for example, here is a desktop PC case from the mid-1990s, which does not include a turbo button or turbo indicator LED. Although, unusually for the time, it still has the CPU speed readout, which is a full 3-digit readout on this one, because a lot of these were only 2 digits, and once CPU speeds reached 100 MHz, all of them suddenly became obsolete. I remember seeing computers which had a 100 MHz CPU, but only a 2-digit display, so usually they either made it read 99, or they just made it read high for turbo mode and low for non-turbo mode, or sometimes they simply left it blank entirely. However, the motherboard in this computer, which is one of those infamous PC Chips M919 VIP motherboards with fake cache, still has the capability of using a turbo indicator LED and a turbo button. So what I've done temporarily is connected the hard drive indicator LED to the turbo indicator LED pinout on the motherboard. And even though we don't have a turbo button on this case, the keyboard commands I mentioned earlier still work. So if I press Control minus, you can see the indicator turned off because we are now running in non-turbo mode. And if I press Control Alt plus, it comes back on and we're now running in turbo mode again. And if we look at the manual for this motherboard, we can see the default for the turbo switch connector is the opposite of what we saw of that previous motherboard. In this case, shorting the pins puts it in normal mode, or slow CPU speed mode, and leaving the pins open, I think they mean open.
Sorry, what? Your arms are wide open? Oh, actually it's pronounced open.
Like O-P-E-N?
Open. You just gotta really enunciate. Just open.
Leaving the pins open with nothing connected to them puts the CPU in turbo mode. So that's the opposite of what we saw before. And this was clearly done with consideration to cases like I just showed, which don't even have a turbo button, so that if you didn't have a turbo button connected to the motherboard and you didn't put a jumper on the pins, in this case it would run in turbo mode instead of running in normal mode. And if I run the PC Tools Relative CPU Performance Index, it gives a score of 226.1. And now in non-turbo mode, our PC Tools Performance Index has dropped all the way down to 19.2. The Pentium era was truly the end of the line for turbo buttons and turbo LEDs on computer cases. A few motherboards still supported them, such as the one in this Cyrix 6x86 system. The manual for the motherboard in this system still mentions the turbo LED indicator. Right here, J3 turbo LED connector, but it doesn't even mention the turbo switch connector, even though they show it on the layout of the board. Most of the time, pressing the turbo button did nothing except turn the turbo LED on and off. It made absolutely no difference in the computer's performance. Or sometimes the turbo button was repurposed for other functions, such as in this case, pressing it causes the computer to go into sleep mode, and pressing it again wakes it up. Now let's look at something the people who write Wikipedia articles and tech blogs have apparently never heard of. It's called a book. This is Upgrading PCs Made Easy, written by Bud and Alex Aaron, and published by Osborne McGraw-Hill in 1991. And right here on page 11, it talks about the turbo mode switch. It says, this is mostly a catchy advertising term, since it does not actually speed up your computer if you press it. Instead, it slows your computer down if you don't press it. And they talk about compatibility with the original IBM PC, and that some computer programs would not work properly if your system runs too fast. Here's another explanation from the book Information Technology and Business Management, written by Dr. Mukesh Dunna. It says, turbo switch. If you're using a PC that has two different speeds of operation, then you will find a turbo switch on the front side of your PC. This switch changes the speed from a low value to a high value, and hence the name turbo. Pressing this switch on will result in running the computer at its highest speed. And here in Lesson 2 of the WizKids Computer Literacy Program, it gives a much more succinct explanation. It says, turbo switch. Activating this switch will make your computer work faster. And Building a PC for Dummies, 5th edition, which was written when most people no longer had a need for the turbo button, mentions, don't forget that turbo button. If your PC does have a turbo button, you might boot your computer one day and find that everything suddenly seems to run slower. If so, your first suspect should be that doggone turbo button. If your PC isn't running in turbo mode, it's forced to run more slowly. And I'm sure some stubborn people might think that these authors all got it wrong. So I found the data sheet for the Intel 486 SL microprocessor, and it says right here, turbo mode is defined as the CPU executing at full speed, the default speed for the system. So that's straight from the horse's mouth. Intel says that turbo mode is the CPU executing at full speed. I know the Wikipedia article about turbo buttons is saying that an authoritative source is required. Well, I think this is about as authoritative as you can get, directly from Intel. So if you want to argue with what Intel wrote 30 years ago, go right ahead. But for the rest of us, I think this has definitively solved the mystery about what the turbo button does, and we've debunked the myth that turbo mode slows down the computer.